Hello everyone, my name is Iranjali and I'm gathered here today with Mrs. Marini de Oliveira, and we are here to talk about loneliness, isolation and gender-based violence in the community.
Yeah, so I would imagine loneliness is something where you actually have like an internal experience. So you could actually be in a crowd where you feel part of the crowd, but then you can actually internally feel lonely as well in terms of being understood or being heard per se. Isolation for me seems like a more deliberate kind of disconnection from the people around you. Isolation can come from, I guess, some form of discrimination.
I think isolation is a much more physical experience, like loneliness. As y'all said, loneliness is even when you're among people, you can feel loneliness. But I think for isolation to actually kick in, it's a much more physical thing.
Just to add to that, like sometimes even in intimate partnerships, like you might be physically together, but you actually probably might have a sense of loneliness if you're not actually connected.
So I think they were right when they said that loneliness is a feeling. Loneliness is actually a feeling that you feel lonely just as a basic need like hunger. It's when you feel that you have a lack of emotional attachment with anyone or any form of emotional or intimacy, or it's an internal experience for sure, and it's subjective and it's one's own experience. And now this is a bit different to social isolation, where intention and unintention comes in. So whilst social isolation can be objective, you can see it by the lack of social networks or lack of people to interact with. So they're tightly related. However, they differ in terms of the intention and also the experience.
When it comes to women, actually, for everyone, all of us, we need a certain kind of support. So, like from parents, we need one kind of support. Then there are friends, family, from siblings. I think in the case of loneliness or even isolation, not having that support at those kind of crucial times, it really limits you, and it could actually just, in a tough situation, it could, having the right support could make so much of a difference.
I think in general for women, especially in Sri Lanka, that isolation or that loneliness comes with how the culture also restricts us. The rules, the beliefs, everything that determines us, it, you know, holds back our identity, it defines who we are as people.
What do you think, Mrs. de Oliveira? How do you think loneliness and isolation affects violence and actually facilitates violence against women?
Sri Lanka has moved away from a community supported system to a very isolated, selfish society. So with regard to loneliness, I think if one is very strong and if one is empowered, you can turn it into a positive thing. Now the bad thing is isolation. Isolation means someone has taken you from the environment that you're happy in and put you into a very adverse, very harsh sort of atmosphere or environment. That's where the problem lies. And also, I think community. All members of the community have a role to play. The religious leaders, the retired senior citizens, they have so much to contribute. The youth, in every neighborhood, there is a youth group who get into trouble sometimes, who are doing things that they are not supposed to do. But they have so much of energy, so much of talent, so much that they can give society. But our education system is such that they insist on exams and getting jobs and competing with each other, that they don't channel these vibrant energies of our young people to make them catalysts, to make their societies and communities a better place.
I think that's true, because at one point through research I read that there are many causes of social isolation. Which could be internal, which yeah. could be situational,
yes.
Like you're in a bad environment, you're stuck in a bad marriage, yeah. And you lack those support systems. And then again, you are, you know, pushed into a corner because you have significant mental or physical health problems.
Yeah.
And also, you know, the gendered norms that the yeah. society has built up. So I think these gender norms are what's really deeply rooted and entrenched in our culture and society. And I think that plays a huge role in how women perceive, even when it comes to help seeking behavior, which we will move on to as we go along. So the next question was,
yes, I mean, when we talk about abuse, we mostly talk about physical abuse, but subjectively, I would argue that actually psychological abuse, actually making a person feel small, is probably even more devastating and more long-term, because you're in some sense kind of creating this psychological cage for that person. And even in a situation where that individual is out of that abusive environment, that those voices or that psychological cage is still governing that person and will just restrict that person's options in terms of what she would like to do. And I think that itself is a form of suffering.
When it hits you mentally, there's a rut that you sometimes fall into, and getting out of that rut takes so long. It mm-hmm. can take years, and sometimes you're too shy to go to a psychologist or to a therapist. So you bottle it up and you keep it in you, and then it festers, and then at some point there's a bursting point.
In terms of the research suggests that there are types of violence that women are exposed to. And this could be from belittlement, from people
name calling,
pushed down. And when you look at the perpetrators, they're mostly the loved ones that are in your close circle. So it'll be your husband, it'll be your mother-in-law, your sister-in-law, and I think that is just devastating. What are your thoughts on that?
Yes, Sri Lanka is a country that is steeped in patriarchal ideologies. So the solution to this problem, what you said is exactly true, but there should be a solution. Solution is that every woman should be trained from the time she's a little girl to empower herself, to find a way out, not to play the role of victim and say, oh, I'm helpless, I'm very sad, but to fight it out. How do you fight it out? You identify among your friends or among your relatives someone, a confidante that you can trust.
Correct. And actually, when you look at the research, it says that these women who have been subject to rape, violence, being pushed, shoved, pulled, beaten with an object, even burnt by their mother-in-laws, husbands and fathers, even brothers, they're highly educated. They're highly educated women, but they choose not to come forward. So there must be something that is in the society that makes them to not come forward. So I think that's something we as a community need to address.
Relates to gender stereotyping. In Sinhala, they say, gedara gini pitata dendepa. Not to say what is happening within the four walls to any outsider. You have to sort out your problems. But if it becomes very dangerous, they should be educated that they have to confide in someone. They have to find a solution outside the home. So it's all about public awareness and education.
When it comes to abuse, there's so much that's unsaid. There's so much you undergo. It's not just the physical side, it's the mental side. It's everything you're feeling when someone just touches you or even looks at you or catcalls you or say something that is undermining your identity. And for that, we don't come forward because we are scared, because of all the constructs that are built around us, because of everything that we've been told not to say. We have been told from the time that we are small, we should not be heard. Women should not be heard. They should not speak out. They should not tell others. Even in our own families, sometimes when we are abused by our own, say, parents or by our relatives or uncles, we are told that's okay, it's normal. It happened to us in an earlier generation. It's something you should ignore. So we hold it back. And we don't hold, and the reason we hold it back is because we are not ready to speak out about it, because Sri Lanka is made such that you feel it's a mistake to bring it upon you, bring it outside, tell your husband. And with that, I feel like there's so much that we undergo as women that so many people don't understand. 60% of the population is abused, according to UN Women, the report. And pregnant women from that is 40% who's abused. So imagine that statistic alone has so much to say.
Yeah, I mean, it's basically like Suhela said, I mean, we are sort of conditioned in that way to sort of, you know, not speak out, or maybe like, you know, just lay low with it, just let it go, or sleep on it, or, you know, just to not acknowledge that it happened or bring it up. And what would the consequences be? What would happen? What kind of shame would it bring on your family and yourself?
Yeah.
Things like that. So I mean, like it's because of all those factors, like, you know, I think that
you can be disowned for
exactly,
it.
Exactly, and yeah. Like so many things. Like
I think also the the constitution of marriage here is considered like such a utmost sacred thing, and you shouldn't bring shame upon that constitution. So women are given that added pressure to kind of maintain that. So if you're suffering in a marriage, and if you divorce here is considered like such a taboo, like if you're divorcing, there's something wrong with it. But the honest truth is, like, you know, you don't owe yourself to another person. You have every right to pursue your happiness. So a lot of families tend to put pressure on their daughters, saying that, you know, that whole Eva Seeming, Sana Seemer kind of thing, which is funny in some sense. Is what you're saying is like, don't shame us, just keep suffering and going on, and things might get better.
So I think spot on. The common reasons as to why they don't come out is because of the embarrassment, the shame that's being brought about to the family. And this is more or less in the city, the research suggests. And like the lady said, yes, pregnant women are being abused. Women are being abused every day, and some of them are okay with it because they think that, you know, that's what they've been conditioned and learnt over the course of their life.
I have to digress a little. We are speaking about the affected person. But what about the perpetrator? The perpetrator, to hit somebody or to verbally abuse someone or to resort to emotional abuse, has to be a very unhappy, unbalanced person. In places like Australia, you get helplines for men. You get places where a man could go and say, well, I'm having a problem in office, can I talk about it? But here the men have to bottle it up. They cannot cry, they cannot confide, they cannot say, it's not macho to say that they're having a problem. So we have to look at the perpetrator. Here even the law, the prevention of domestic violence law, looks at chasing away the perpetrator from the house. But where does he go when he's sent out of the matrimonial home? So we are not focusing on the perpetrator and his problems. It's all about power and control. Someone with power, patriarchal power, is using that power to cause violence.
And do you see a rise in this violence over the period of the past year during COVID?
Yes, there was a huge rise in the incidence of domestic violence cases, because the frustration was taken from the person, the so-called person, weaker sex, from the children and from the wife.
I disagree. Because just because you don't fight back doesn't mean you want to.
The question, I think, comes from, I think, two aspects. One is the moral aspect, which is, other aspect is, I think, the legal aspect, because in the court of law, how can you actually, so say for example, I'm a woman, I've been raped, I didn't show any signs of this thing for some reason. It could have been fear, this thing, I don't have any scars to show, so then how can I show that? And that's, it's a very weird thing, because yeah, how do you handle a case like that?
That's true, because a lot of emotional abuse goes unreported because there is no physical symptoms to prove that. And what the lady said about being raped, it's shocking to note that this study done by the UN found that women thought that the way they dress and behave, the woman is to be blamed if they were raped, and also that if a woman doesn't physically fight back, and if they don't give consent, that's not rape. So these types of perceptions, I think, give us some evidence as to what types of gendered norms are out there, and why women accept. They're very docile when it comes to these forms of perceptions, I guess.
On a positive note, victims' rights has been recognized by Parliament, and we have a Victims and Witnesses Protection Act. But still, there is no awareness about this act and about the rights of victims and how you deal with this sort of issues. So there has to be public education once again.
Correct. I completely disagree.
100% disagree.
Disagree.
I definitely disagree with that.
Well, this is not like the, Stone Age or something, where men have to go and hunt and the women need to take care of the children. We are way past that.
Yeah, so I think all this is coming from like a very traditional view of civilization per se, because back in the day, I think human rights and like individual rights were not important. It's a question of how well we are bringing forth our generations and increasing our civilization per se. So it's a very mechanical way of looking at it, whereas men used to go out, hunt and or create economies, and women used to consider the more reproductive side of things in terms of making sure the house is good and the children. So it's like you see this kind of mechanical kind of relationship between men and women. But what has happened is that we've come to a state where we've populated the planet. We don't honestly need to get married and have kids. I'm just putting it out there. I'm just saying, if you do want to have kids, fine. It should come from the heart. I definitely believe that. But there's no pressure to do that. And in this situation, I feel the power to the individual becomes very important. So then, as a man, if I want to start cooking or going into more aspects of nurturing or taking care of your family, why not? And there are people like that. There are people who are this thing, and they're stay-home dads, and guys, I think, give a lot of pressure to each other in terms of not doing that kind of thing. So I think now the opportunities are open to for people to pursue whatever they want.
A small note on that. I have to challenge that notion, because majority of the crimes that are being reported are from cities compared to the rural areas, the majority. So that means that you have different probably strata of demographies, and then it's about how we strategize and tailor those awareness programs to those different strata living in the city, because seems like we are not on par and we are not on the same ground when it comes to gender-based violence at the moment.
That is because the women in cities may be more sensitized than the rural women.
Yes.
Yes. And just it's not that it does not happen in the villages. And it happens more.
More. And it's probably underreported.
It's underreported.
Or not reported at all.
Because they are so wrapped up in finding the three meals to the table, rather than thinking about themselves.
I disagree.
I think sexuality is something which is belongs to everyone. Men show their sexuality in terms of showing the strength and you know, prowess and etc. Women also have that need to kind of show their sexuality as well. And you don't show your sexuality just because you want certain type of attention. Sometimes you do that for your own self, and that space should be provided. I think it's a part of empowerment in some sense. Yeah. And I can't understand why men can't see that as an opportunity for empowerment for themselves. Like, do you always want to be a slave to your eyes?
Clothes don't define how you are as a person. They don't define your identity. That's a wrong statement if that's how our nation thinks, which they do. Most of the aunties and the uncles still say, chi, mehema dandinne, and they tell us all the time.
I think when it comes to like catcalling, I think one thing I've noticed among men is that when you see a confident woman, really strong in their sexuality, a lot of men feel very insecure. Because it threatened by it, it kind of calls out their masculinity as well. So because of that anxiety, they catcall because of that. But if you address them, they tend to get like really scared.
It's a,
yeah. I think that's what they're trying to protect. This whole idea of covering a woman is that shit.
I think belittling comes a lot, which is reported, could be due to this insecurity.
Woman is that shit, I can't handle myself, so you need to cover yourself.
So moving forward, I think a few points towards the end. There are actually programs out there, called Mitrupiasa, that connects the mental health, the health sector with the police, the midwives. But most of the knowledge about these programs tend to be amongst these public sectors and those authorities.
It doesn't go out there to the general public.
So I think our prime goal of having this conversation was to let the public know that it is really imperative to be aware of what's going on in your community, in our community, because it does escalate, it does have ripple effects. If one is not well healthy, if one is not healthy, if one is not mentally well, then obviously they suffer. And then, the economy suffers, the community suffers.
Yeah, burden on the economy.
Yes, and also by sending, if they do reach out for help, and they're asked to go back to those
perpetrators
in the name of the family and to feel less ashamed because of the stigma, then aren't we putting them at higher risk of future violence? So these are some things that we need to ponder on and probably take action at the grassroots level.
That's why shelters and safe houses are very important at every neighborhood.
Do you think we have enough shelters and...
Far from it. Very few. And those are also not funded by the state. So it's very sad. That's what we need at this moment. A safe space for a woman to go and think, what am I going to do? Am I going back to the perpetrator? Or am I starting a new life? Am I going to train myself in income generation activities? What am I going to do with my children? She needs a space to think. And that space should be available to her.
So that's it for us from today. Let's build healthy and happy and safe environments. Thank you.